And we're back.
Woo-hoo!
All right. This is, again, the All-Star Wars episode, pretty much. I found some really fascinating stuff about, and this is common knowledge now, but I just thought it was so cool. But I found this in the Hollywood Reporter. I just wanted to read it. This was great. Red Leader and Gold Leader.
Standing by.
Who are in the movie.
Mm-hmm. I love how they did that.
One of the actors is still alive.
Oh, really?
And came in and voiced over the footage. It was Gold Leader. I forgot the actor's name. But this is the filmmakers walking around. Gareth Edwards. They're at Skywalker Ranch doing research for the movie. And he says, we're walking around doing all the cool things that you do at Skywalker Ranch. You know, looking at the Millennium Falcon and trying on Han Solo's jacket and things
what?
Like that.
Like you do.
And in the back of the room at the bottom were all of these cans of film. And Ed was like, what is that? And they said, oh, it's Star Wars. What do you mean? Well, it's just some footage that we didn't use. Just extra footage from the original movie that didn't get used.
How are they? Is it so usable?
They had to clean it up. It was negatives. Yeah. They cleaned it up. They found original negatives from A New Hope that included deleted scenes of the pilots from the Death Star attack. That was most of the footage was that, you know, so it's guys sitting in
half, rocking back and forth,
you know, back and forth and going, you know, saying military stuff.
Red Five, standing by.
And
oh,
there was,
Red Five.
And there was an X-Wing call exchange that didn't make it into A New Hope and all that. So he took that footage back to Industrial Light and Magic. They cleaned it up. They fixed it. And then they had Gold Leader, the actor, come in and voice his part.
That's so cool.
It's so nice.
That was probably my favorite part about one of my favorite little nods, because they, you know, they wanted to nod to nostalgia and everything. But that was when I was like, oh, you fuckers, that's good.
Mm-hmm. I just think it's nice that the manager at Domino's gave him the time off.
Well, they found a reel of stuff from Return of the Jedi of all the female pilots that they shot. They shot dozens of pilots to have interaction during the big Death Star fight in Jedi. And they cut most of it. It was like almost all the pilots had their dialogue cut out of it. But one of the actors looks an awful lot like Poe Dameron's mom. She's an A-Wing pilot during the Death Star attack.
That's in the comic.
It's in the comic. So they actually modeled the drawings that they made of Poe's mom based off of one of the pilots in an A-Wing from unused footage.
Girls
from
can't
of the Jedi.
Fly?
Yes, they can. Yes, they can.
But this movie, I don't know where people are ranking where they think, you know, their favorite Star Wars movies are, and I'm seeing an awful lot of people saying Empire, Rogue One, and then A New Hope. The order of your favorites.
Damn.
So my ranking's unpopular and controversial.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
He goes the Ewok Adventure.
No, I don't.
Droids, the cartoon.
Star Wars Christmas.
Not canon.
Not canon anymore.
None of that's canon.
Sorry. So,
yeah.
Did you guys see, actually, they did a whole episode of Goldberg's about that? About the holiday special?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. I was laughing so hard because he bought it bootlegged, which I did at Dragon Con when I was like 14. And he pops it into the VCR. And Kat's like, what's the holiday special? And I go,
oh, no.
Hang on a second. And so I paused it, and I brought up YouTube, because it's on YouTube.
Yeah, you can watch.
And I go, we're not watching the whole thing, because this thing is fucking awful. And I, like, you know, just showed her, you know, Chewie's family, B. Arthur being a fucking cantina bartender.
Don't forget Lumpy.
Oh, yeah, Lumpy, like, everything like that, you know?
B. Arthur's
and
song
Kat's
with,
like,
with Greedo.
Kat goes, Jesus. What is this shit? Like, yeah. She's like, this is awful.
That's CBS then, trying to make some money.
But the thing about that episode of the Goldbergs is the look on his face as he's watching it, we all had that look.
Well, that's the thing, though.
We were there. I was like, I'm that kid. I'm right there. If you
watch that, though, I love it, because at the end of it, he turns around because he's watching it with his dad.
Yeah, I did the same thing.
And he goes, that was fantastic. And his dad goes, were we watching the same thing? Like that? You know, because he's trying to fool himself, because he's like, oh, my God, what was that?
Yeah, because my dad hadn't seen Star Wars. He'd just seen this. And he's like, this is what you are obsessing about?
This is what you're going out to see every Friday?
This is you? This is I'm taking you to see this every night over at the Hewish Theater in Payson? This is what you're... Oh, Jesus.
And why was Mark Hamill so goddamn tan?
I showed the Christmas special part of it to the kids at the Sev a couple years ago.
And they were...
And they just looked at me like, I'm so sorry you had to live through this.
So it's so bad.
But anyway, I really enjoyed this Rogue One movie so much. I really did, because it to me, how I described it, well, two reasons. First of all, it's the first time, and I know this is maybe bad to say, it's the first time I ever felt like the Star Wars universe was real.
Lived in.
It's grounded.
Lived in. Which is the terminology they always use to describe the original trilogy. This felt more lived
but
in
this
than
this felt more real when they were on that planet, all those different races. And
on Jedha?
On Jedha, yeah. And that's when I went, this is real.
Yeah.
It existed for me. It wasn't just a movie set.
I agree.
You know?
Jedha's super trippy, too, because they're hinting that Jedha is either where the Jedi got their name or Jedha got its name from the Jedi.
Yeah.
No one knows, because it's like this spiritual, not necessarily the homeworld of the Jedi, but one of the early.
There's a fucking mountain with like a...
Yeah, statues.
Lightsaber. Is
Jedi
statue?
Everywhere. Yeah.
Jedi statues.
This shit was crazy.
Yeah, and they're mining the old temple for Kyber crystals, and what they won't say, the story group won't say, it's either that, because Kyber crystals are mostly on Ilum, right? There's this big ice planet, and the Padawans would go there, and their crystal would call to them, and they'd build their lightsaber. But Jedha's where all these crystals are at, so is it because it's full of crystals, or are they just mining crypts of old Jedi Knights?
Hmm.
I think for me, what made it even more realistic, and it's easily what technology what got us there, is, you know, we saw in A New Hope the Death Star blow up Alderaan, but you just saw a planet go kabah.
Yeah.
You know, like that. And like, yeah, that's devastating. Holy shit.
You may fire when ready.
But on this one, we're on the ground.
Yeah.
And you see it.
That's the
bam,
other thing.
Bam.
Yeah.
And you see, like,
that
the
was
explosion
the
and, like,
it.
And the fucking ground coming up, and they're like, we gotta get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. You know? And the other reason I like this one so much is this is the first time I felt like, and maybe I'm just projecting, and this is me. This was a Star Wars movie made for the adult fan.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I think.
Yeah.
You know,
well,
yeah,
get
kids,
more
are,
out of it.
Kids are seeing it. But this one was made for the guys like us who went as often as we could to see the original, as often as we could.
Well, I'll tell you what I love about this movie. Yeah. Is that not only does it not harm the only other three movies, it like enhances it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It enhances all of them.
I haven't watched A New Hope since I've seen it, but
I have.
I've done it three times.
And it fucking the way that it you're like, ah!
Well, but like knowing like you know, because I know the scene. You know, the first time you see Vader in New Hope, he blows the door open, he walks out, and he's like, you know, he lifts that dude up like by his neck.
Mm-hmm.
But like knowing now,
he's so tired
that he just fucking murdered like
a dozen
20,
people,
20 dudes in a fucking hallway. And he, you know, and just barely missed those plans. You know what I mean? Like, it makes it so much more intense.
And if you're one of those people complaining about the sassy as fuck, be careful not to choke on your aspirations line. Vader is sassy as fuck through the original trilogy.
Oh yeah,
His most sassy line of all would be "apology accepted" after a dude's corpse falls down dead at his feet.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
You know, he is a sassy fucking quippy dude.
That's, I would be if I had to spend my time in a fucking meditation chamber.
But what's interesting?
In that chamber scene, dude, when he's floating in that water with like no arms.
Yeah, who builds a fucking castle where he got his legs chopped off?
Yeah, in Mordor.
That's Mustafar. That's where Obi-Wan basically made him.
Well, there were no ramps for him to wheelchair away.
Yeah.
he had to stay there. You know?
He also, if you read the Vader comics, you can see it's all, again, tied together so beautifully well. Part of the reason why he was so insane to get those plans back, he doesn't like the Death Star, but he knew the Emperor was intrigued by it. And you see the fallout of the Death Star's destruction through those 25 issues.
And again, if you're not reading that, and you're a Star Wars fan, you're doing it wrong.
Yeah.
Because it all ties
and it's
together.
All it's all wrapped up now. So if you're waiting for the end of the story, it bridges the 2 years or the 2 or 3 years between Empire and Star Wars beautifully.
Mm-hmm,
so
I agree with Gary, though. It definitely made it feel real. Like, because shit, I'm dumping American history like and world history out of my brain so I can fit more Star Wars history. Like, I'm going to be a useless human being in about 5 years.
Well, it's not the story of Camelot where you have King Arthur and Lancelot and Guinevere running around with very few consequences that are not mythic. These are the ground troops that are fighting against the other castle, and so it's gritty and it's visceral and it's disturbing.
Well, and it was what's the movie? It's Saving Private Ryan,
right?
At certain points,
it's the cost of war.
Yeah, it's real people are fucking dying.
Oh yeah, that
you
was
know,
the,
and
when,
that's,
when Baze
you know?
When Baze was running, and yes. you see the fucking what is it, the A wing or the U wing go down, and he's like, oh. Like, he has that look like, fuck.
You know, that's our last U-Wing.
Yeah, he's just like, ah.
They only had three or four.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But then when the fucking, the Hammerhead Corvette takes the other Star Destroyer, and you watch that bitch come down in slow-mo.
So good.
Shannon and I were like, ah.
Yeah. So every single time, too.
Cat and I said.
All four times I've seen it, I've just been like, oh this
the,
is so cool.
It replaced my favorite Star Destroyer destruction scene.
What's the other one?
When Darth Vader's executor plows right into
in
the Death Star.
Jedi.
In Jedi.
When the rebels are trying to leave and get the fuck out of Dodge,
they
fucking run right into the goddamn destroyer, and I'm like, Jesus.
Yeah, because Vader prescribes to the Riker technique of using your ship as a battering ram.
Yeah. It's fucking insane. No, but
I'll say this. This was a great year of watching spaceships get destroyed.
Yeah.
Because watching the Enterprise in Beyond.
And that was another thing. And I even thought about Star Trek Beyond because I worked 12 years of satellite communications in the military. So if you, like, there were parts where I was sitting next to a work buddy the first time I saw it. There were parts about this movie where we are just high-fiving each other because only you would deal with this, like only comm guys would get. If you're a comm guy and you're watching this movie, you're like, yeah, don't talk shit about comm. You know, like when we did our little after review when we came out of the movie and I said, no comm, no bomb. That's kind of like, that's always been our motto. You can't fucking do shit without comm and cybersecurity. And it fucking still makes me laugh that huge Death Star thing that blows up planets, travel spaceships that could fly through hyperspace, but we're still putting plans on a goddamn floppy disk. Like, it's just funny to me.
Got some final stuff. Gareth Edwards talking about Jedha. Planet of spiritual pilgrimage in a world where the Jedi have been blotted out of existence. It's now pretty much a place that exemplifies the galaxy we see in the original Star Wars films. One just two decades removed from the Jedi, but already treating them like a lost myth. The Force is basically in Star Wars like a religion, and they're losing their faith in that period. And we start the movie. We're trying to find a physical location that we could go to speak to the themes of losing your faith and the choice between letting the Empire win or evil win, and good prevailing. It got embodied in the place we called Jedha. He says Jedha. He kind of teases that the Empire are on Jedha for reasons beyond the fact that it was formerly a Force stronghold.
Yeah.
It's essentially taken over by the Empire. It's occupied territory for reasons that I can't reveal.
Because it might be tying into one of the newer trilogy movies.
Or Rebels, even, for that matter.
Yeah.
There's something very important in Jedha that serves both the Jedi and the Empire. Felt very much like something that we could relate to in the real world. So there's that, and the whole Kyber Crystal thing. Also, he talks about Galen Erso. His big decision. Why would a respectable scientist end up building a moon-sized superweapon anyway? We kind of touched on it earlier. He was always a pacifist, he says, and part of an audible sponsor. His act of defiance in sabotaging the first Death Star makes him a rebel for sure. He risked his life for it. In the writing, it was always intended as an act of defiance and always a way to unmake what he was forced to help make.
Yep.
He says, I love the poetry in that way that it falls to the daughter to absolve the sins of the father.
Just like it fell to the son to absolve the sins of the father.
As he says, that feels like Star Wars to me.
Yep.
So there you go.
There's a funny thing on Jedha, too, that I love because it gets into what I like to call the new movies kind of fixing the expanded universe. If you're a fanboy that's been screaming and crying about the expanded universe being stripped down and made non-canon, it was a mess, and you need to recognize that. Mm-hmm, so there was a Boba Fett's backstory was that he was a space cop named Jaster Mereel, and that Jaster Mereel became so obsessed with hunting down a particular bounty that he disgraced himself as a cop and had to become a bounty hunter, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Didn't work for Fett when they retconned him, right?
Yeah.
In the prequels. Well, there's a guy named Tam Pozla. He's a bounty hunter that's wandering around the streets of Jedha hunting down two bounties that he's looking for, one who goes by Rufo. I can't remember the other guy's name. But he's been hunting for him because they've been traveling the galaxy doing medical experiments on people, horrible medical experiments on people. And he became so obsessed with it that he became a bad space cop and had to become a bounty hunter. So they just basically retconned Jaster Mereel's shitty Boba Fett story and made him another kind of cool bounty hunter. The two guys he's hunting are actually in Rogue One. It's Ponda Baba and Dr. Evazan.
Oh, yeah.
Who as we saw what happened to them in Episode 4. Dr. Evazan's story, Cornelius Evazan, goes back to the 12th episode of Clone Wars, where you see his shuttered plastic surgery clinic on a street on a planet. If you read Arabash, you can see that it's closed due to an investigation. That's why his face is all fucked up, because he was disfigured when somebody got even with him. He's on Jeddah basically finding body parts to stitch back together.
He's Frankenstein.
He's Frankensteining his way through, and Ponda Baba just likes getting drunk and hanging out with him. So this
I'm Ponda Baba.
They're leaving Jeddah when they bump into Jen and Cassian. It's all in this book. It's kind of beautiful. They're leaving because this bounty hunter's figuring out where they're at, and there's pictures all through. If you haven't read the Ultimate Visual Guide for Rogue One, they don't come right out and say that it's Dr. Evazan. They keep talking about Rufo, mm-hmm. but if you know that that's his alias, you're like, oh fuck, this guy. There's a picture of this lady. She's holding a coffee pot. She's got half a head. He's basically going around and creating these mindless servants called the Decraniated that he sells to coffee shops.
What the fuck?
Wow.
So
that's
here's
fucked up.
Here's the bounty hunter that's hunting him down. Here's one of his Decraniated. And on the next page, there's a guy that not only doesn't have a head, but his guts are hanging out of his robot legs. This shit's all on Jeddah. It's all in the background. So, you know, if you're looking for stuff to look out for next time you watch Rogue One.
I want to know who the... all right, when Bodhi gets to... when they get to Jeddah and they're trying to get him to Saul, who's the dog with the gas mask or whatever?
That's those are the two tubes. Two tubes twins. And
oh, there's two of them?
Yeah, they're twins. They these guys right
yeah,
here.
Yeah, yeah.
So...
I didn't even know there was two of them.
Yeah, they're clones of each other.
Okay.
So, and that's kind of a fun one. And that X-Wing that's crashed, it's a cut scene, but one of them's piloting that X-Wing and he gets shot down.
That's
and he's
crazy.
Such a badass, he just gets out and keeps fighting.
I want a movie where the two criminals, what's their name is again?
Hmm?
The two guys you were talking about from New Hope.
Dr. Evazan and Ponda Baba.
I want a scene where he walks off, the guy with the fucked up nose, and he's like, I'm a wanted man. I have a distance on 12 systems. I'm a wanted man. I have a distance on 12 systems. And he goes, come back!
Well, one of those 12 systems is Jeddah. And then the Twi'lek.
Who brags about that shit? That shit is weak.
A fool.
Yeah, a fool.
He is a fool.
He's been on the run for at least 20 years.
He's on a different system. Yeah. It's okay.
And then this dude here, the other Twi'lek that was hanging out with...
Mm-hmm.
with
is that Bib Fortuna's buddy?
It's his cousin. He's Beezer Fortuna. His last name's Fortuna.
Yo, who's the little guy? The little
that's my
that,
favorite.
That's right here. This
little,
is one of my favorite
furry
guys.
Guy
with the big
furry
with
guy.
The big
he's
mouth.
Hanging out of the fucking
making the monkey making the monkey noises.
Yeah,
he was great.
So that's
is he up in like the ship with the Gatling gun?
Yeah, yeah,
he's
on the U-wing.
That's a Warwick.
That's one of my favorite.
It
parts.
Is Warwick Davis.
Warwick Davis.
Yeah.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
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 Fucking great,
he's,
man.
Of course, he's gonna steal the show. He's Leprechaun.
Yeah.
I'm almost to him. The sad thing about these visual guides, though, is that every single character has a name and a background story.
Yeah, they've all been fleshed out.
So there's Pow, but he wasn't. He's taller. And then
I
the
liked
little
him.
Little
that
dude's
guy
name
right
is Bistan.
Oh, I liked him too.
Bistan. Yeah, the little guy's name is Bistan.
Bistan. Yeah, and Bistan's the crazy fucker that likes heavy ammunition.
That shit was awesome.
So he's kind of like their Rocket Raccoon.
He's very much. Yeah,
but he was a badass.
I mean, Warwick's been in every Star Wars movie since Return of the Jedi.
No.
He even got to play Little Greedo in episode one.
That's right, he was.
The two things I want to mention real fast is one is I love the little hints where you know something's going to happen kind of thing, whereas when Jimmy Smith shows up.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And like, you know, he's sitting there and he's like, I've got somebody I'd trust her with my life, and it's Slaya.
Yeah.
Yep.
And mm-hmm. he goes, but I got to go back to Alderaan.
Yeah,
and
I'm like, no,
man.
No,
Jimmy Smith.
In my mind, he didn't get there. He went somewhere else.
Like, I was like, no, man. I was like, oh, shit.
And
in your mind, he stopped for coffee somewhere.
Yeah. if you're a Clone Wars fan.
Like in Spaceballs.
Yeah. Like, oh, shit.
If you're a Clone Wars fan, there's like probably 60 episodes with Bail Organa, you know, being a badass and developing that. And, you know, keep in mind, in episode 3, he was the only dude who went to the temple to see if he could help.
Yeah,
he flies down to the temple and watch that kid get gunned down. Yeah. He's like, oh, we're fucked.
That's right.
But we mentioned, you know, the hallway scene, and they obviously they pass the plans along. They get to the ship, and then they
floppy disk.
That door slides open, and you just see the white dress with the hood over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the first time I saw it, Carrie was still with us.
Yes.
The second time I saw it was the day after we lost her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they said, you know, what did they bring us? And then it camera pans around, and it's young Carrie Fisher, and she says Hope, and like I seriously like got teary eyed, because one, it's a great ending, but also, it's like, what a way to go out.
Yeah. Also, you know? Changes the meaning of A New Hope.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah,
wow,
drastically.
Well, and then I can't believe we haven't even talked about Grand Moff Tarkin.
You may fire when ready.
Yeah, well,
Sansi Pants.
I just like saying that all the time.
People talk about that now. I mean, we can talk about Tarkin, but like, because now that we've lost Carrie, and you and I were talking about this last night, that I guess a rumor is that General Organa was going to have a big part in Nine.
Well, I've got that information right here.
And do you use that technology, or do you rewrite the story?
Well, I think you ask her daughter.
Well,
what she wants.
They're meeting this week. To talk about that.
Well, that's what you were saying, that he had to fly to California and be like,
Yeah.
what do we do?
By the way,
they're done filming 8, right?
All of her scenes have been shot.
Since August.
Did you see what she got married in?
Yeah. Let's talk about that. First of all, let's raise a glass to Carrie Fisher.
Oh, she's such a badass. You showed me that last night and almost lost my shit.
She got cremated.
Yeah.
And her urn looks like a giant Prozac pill.
It was according to her brother, her prized possession was a 2-foot plastic Prozac pill. And so she loved that. She thought it was hysterical. So they hollowed it out and had her urn.
Oh, she already had it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Her daughter and her brother said it was one of her prized possessions.
Oh, my God.
She is brilliant.
Yeah,
God,
absolutely.
It made me laugh so hard.
So, yeah, they're meeting this week to talk about it. According to Hollywood Reporter, at least 2 key scenes are planned for episode 8 and episode 9, a Leia reunion with Luke Skywalker.
Oh, goddamn it.
And a confrontation with Kylo Ren.
Which has to happen.
Yeah. I mean, her.
Oh, yeah, you know, mom and son.
Yep.
Whoop that ass.
Details of where those scenes fit in the movies remain unclear, but insiders say that Leia was to have a bigger part in episode 9 than 8. And the director has finished shooting. But they haven't started a 9 yet, so they're not quite sure what to do with the story now.
I agree with you. You know, family first, whatever they want. But like after the Tarkin thing, the technology's there.
It's there,
and it looked great.
The guys in charge of that technology are really, really hesitant to use it. Like they used it for Tarkin because Tarkin had to be there, and people complaining about the technology that was used, saying it looked fake,
because it was.
Well, also, people who didn't know that actor's been dead for 20 years since 1994 had no idea.
They had no idea.
And also, you're going off of lighting that was different in episode 4 than it is in Rogue One. Yeah. So, I mean, they had to take all of that into consideration.
I mean, episode 4, it looked like any movie from the 70s.
Yeah.
I mean, it shot on film, lit that way. All movies from the 70s kind of look that way.
Well, and this is the first time they've convincingly brought a dead actor back and had them do a performance, a really good performance, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be looking back on this maybe in 20 years and going, oh, that looks weird. But just like we look at
Jeff
all
Bridges
motion capture now.
Tron.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But how many years ago? That was like, what, 5 years ago?
A little bit more than that. I'd say 8.
But either way, but look how far they've come.
Yeah. Exactly. And if that in fact did take you out of the movie, I feel sorry for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because
I loved it.
It enhanced it.
Because I watched those new Planet of the Apes movies, and when the bad guy ape says human work and touches his scars, I see a performance there. I don't see a computer generated creature. To me, that is a thing. That is a living thing, and he has emotions.
I see the legacy of Jar Jar Binks.
Well, yeah.
I mean, hate the character. No, hate the character. Hate the character for what he is.
It started to
recognize what that started, though.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. No, I agree.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying with the whole Leia thing is that, you know, we're still talking 2 years away, and the technology is only going to get better.
Mm-hmm.
So,
it's hard because the character does have to have a resolution. And, that resolution would be great if that resolution was she maybe gets to survive and her legacy lives on. This is a character who's been manipulating the Force accidentally.
Yeah.
That's something they're hinting at very strongly, that even when she's a teenager, she is somehow ahead of the game all the time, and no one knows how. Like, she's her tactical brilliance. Mm-hmm. Watch episode 4 again, as Shannon has, and realize that she takes over the rescue mission the second they show up.
I said it last week. She rescued these 2 lunkheads.
They accidentally stumbled into her detention cell.
Yeah.
She saves them.
The thing is that, God, I forgot who the writer was, but she was going on about how Leia and General Organa are the most... She's the most important character in the entire
they're saga. They're saying that there's a little bit of an inkling out there that if you read Bloodlines, the Princess Leia book that takes place about 6 years before Force Awakens, it's hinted at very strongly that she disguised her rescue of Han Solo as an assassination attempt to destabilize the Outer Rim. So it wasn't anything to do, as far as the rebellion was concerned. The Alliance wasn't concerned about saving the smuggler. That was her plan. But she basically presented to them as, I'm going to take the last Jedi Knight in the galaxy and go kill Jabba the Hutt, who basically runs crime in the Outer Rim.
We're going to assassinate him. Yeah.
Right. We're going to go kill him. We know we're going to kill him. That's the out. That's the whole surrender or die. Yeah, that was just a George Bushianism, you know. Yeah. So the plan was to kill him, destabilize the Outer Rim, because once that's destabilized, once all the gangsters are out trying to kill each other to take power, the Empire will be too busy putting out that fire to deal with the attack against the Death Star.
So her strangling him, that was
all
her
part of
being
the plan.
A cold-hearted
yep.
general. She's
and that's why their move to change that costume from Slave Leia to Hutt Slayer Leia. Well, she did. If you get into what he is, he literally is Don Corleone of the Outer Rim. Mm-hmm. He runs everything. Slavery,
yeah.
Drugs,
crime.
It all goes through Jabba. Yeah. He runs Black Sun. He runs everything out there.
It's going to be interesting. I mean, not only with, obviously, with Carrie Fisher, like with Star Wars, but even with the whole Anton Yelchin thing with Star Trek, how these two giant franchises handle these kind of things.
Yeah, it'll be a little bit easier with Anton Yelchin. But
not as big as a character.
Yeah.
Just transfer him to the Reliant earlier in his career.
There you go. Yeah. speaking of Carrie Fisher, this is not how these things happen, but it was a nice thought, and it was started by a guy from here in Utah. Cody Christensen started an online petition for Disney to declare Leia an official Disney princess. To me, when Disney bought Lucasfilm, she became a Disney princess to me.
Yeah.
She's a general, man. All right, she is a general. Yeah.
She doesn't talk to animals, so that's kind of one of the criteria.
I guess what he's what he's angling for, I think, is that so that she could be in the park.
Yeah,
you know, and you can have your
which would be nice.
I
think that would be nice.
That would be cool. Anyway, and then the final bit of Star Wars news I have here is the Han Solo standalone film. They are talking to Woody Harrelson. As of this moment, talking to Woody Harrelson to be in that movie as
a drunk advisor, please.
A mentor.
Yeah.
To Han.
He's already done it.
Kind of like the Finnegan to his Oliver.
And I hope that mentor's name is Lorsan Tekka.
He's done it twice already.
Yeah, in Hunger Games.
They've talked about that character's name and another character's name, but that's just speculation. Speculation on the web.
And if you really want to have some fun catching up on what happened between Episode 6 and Episode 7, Chuck Wendig's Aftermath books, the two that are out right now, really, really, really fill in a lot of gaps getting up to why Jakku's even important to begin with.
Everybody wants to go back to Jakku.
Well, there's a reason why everybody wants to go back to Jakku. They just don't know it. So there's something there, and it all feeds into...
And it'll all come...
Even if you want to know what happened to Boba Fett's armor... Not necessarily.
I left my wallet in Jakku.
That's where the third Death Star is buried.
Yeah. Well, they used the Empire used tractor beams to pull Alliance ships out of the sky. So
the fuck out of here.
Yeah,
what?
They had a tractor beam installation on the surface of Jakku because Palpatine, for some reason, was excavating Sith artifacts on Jakku.
Jesus.
So when the battle breaks out over Jakku and the Alliance definitely has the superiority in ships, they're blowing the shit out of Star Destroyers, knocking them out of the sky, the whole thing. And then all of a sudden, tractor beams just start pulling, crashing them onto the planet. It's pretty badass.
I want my own lifesaver.
The Sci-Fi Channel, Channel Zero.
Creepypasta?
It's the creepypasta guys, but it's Candle Cove with the Tooth Child.
Yeah.
Creepy as fuck, man.
Sounds creepy.
Candle Cove is how I found Creepypasta about 5 years ago, and it freaked my shit. Like, you know, hair on the back of your neck.
I keep thinking of Shannon as I watch this, and I'm like, he would lose his shit.
Are they doing the whole
I'm not gonna watch it then.
Are they doing the whole thing with the puppet and the kids show and all that? Oh fuck no, I'm not watching it.
It's creepy as fuck. Yeah. I haven't finished it yet, so I don't know if they ended it properly, but I'm 3/4 of the way through, and I'm happy.
I'm going to recommend that since the new season of The Expanse is hitting Sci-Fi really, really quickly, watch the first season. It is the best science fiction on television.
That's what I keep hearing.
Which one?
The Expanse.
I need to watch it.
It's brutal. It's a crime noir, science fiction, political thriller, clusterfuck, mindbender, whatever movie show. But it's right. It's really, really good.
All right, Mr. B, if you would.
I am one with the ham. The ham is with me. I am one with the ham. The ham is with me. I am one with the ham. The ham is with me.